We move on to our first panel discussion. We're slightly behind time, but that happens when you have such interesting conversations happening. So we apologize for that, but I'm absolutely sure that we can make it up sooner. So it's time for our first panel discussion, and the topic of the panel discussion is building a distinct brand in a cluttered digital ecosystem. We have an eclectic panel of speakers to discuss the topic. You can see it on your screen. Let me quickly introduce you to them. The session chair, Aisha Nagar, MD, NEPA, India. Also, the panelists would be Ashish Lingamnani, head of brand Swiggy, Mani Ranganajan, group CEO, housing.com, makan.com, and proptiger.com, Mr. Sai Narayan, chief marketing officer, paisabazaar.com, Siddharth Dabade, managing director, India, and Sark MIQ. So that's your panel, ladies and gentlemen. I will hand it over to Ms. Naga out here.
Thanks a lot, Ravin. Hello, everybody. Nuances of brand voice has never been so delicate in the last 17 months, in the last 2 years, and we have seen that in the preceding sessions. Right from sales-driven strategies, we have seen shift to solution-driven strategies. We have seen brand voices completely changing, retrospect to the changing consumer cycle, and it has never been complex for a marketer to really think about how the differentiated positioning for the brand today is going to be. Now, on that note, I go straight into our session with the topic that we would be discussing in the next 60 minutes, how to create that very distinctive and differentiated brand voice in a very cluttered ecosystem. And we are joined in by a very strong panel, a great mix of both brands who are championing the way for building these brands or supporting these brand stories. With that, I think I'll open up with an opening note from everybody and invite on a very broad question, might be an umbrella question sorts, but let's see everyone's take on how the last 2 years' journey has been. Some stories in terms of rapid response to the pandemic, how it has been look at these changing image associations. We also have a great mix of industries. We'll begin with you, Ashish, from the Swiggy house, and like how the stories has been for the sector.
Hey, hi. Thanks, Isha. Great to be on the panel. Good afternoon, I guess, to all the other panelists as well. So, Isha, I think amongst all the industries that were impacted, I think we've seen two fairly distinct waves and how that's kind of like panned out for us. Like everyone else, we were caught by surprise right in the beginning. And I think the first direct translation for us was a fair amount of, in general, fear and paranoia from consumers with respect to ordering. And I think that was the primary task at hand, along with actually also launching a lot of new service lines at that point in time. So we were in war mode, on war footing. We launched services across grocery and lots of cities, which we didn't really offer before that. We obviously were looking to stabilize our own services, work with government authorities to kind of like make sure that, as in basic things like mobility, et cetera, is allowed for essential services, right? So once basically the hygiene was kind of like sorted, I think we then moved back to building trust. And that was essentially last year for us. We'll probably talk more a little bit about that down the line. This year has obviously been different. I think we've seen a lot more with the lockdowns this year. We've seen consumers relying a lot more on ordering to kind of like get by. And for us, services like Genie have really kind of like been a real boon for consumers. We've seen them using it really, really, as in frequently to kind of like whether it's send food to people in, as in friends and family, take care of loved ones. So I think definitely been a very different 2021. So that's been our experience.
Great. Thanks for opening, Ashish. Now, from combating stories in food delivery, let's move on to Sai. What's your perspective on building in these differentiated strategies from finance perspective? You are on mute, I guess, Sai. Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks for the introduction and hello to the fellow panelists. So again, like Ashish, I think, said, the last 2 years have been very, very interesting, tough, challenging, and also a lot of learning. Because at least the initial phase was a lot of shock, both for us and for the consumers, especially because we were one of the largest lending platforms and fintech platforms. And what happened the moment the first lockdown was announced is that lending almost came to a halt, and also the moratorium was announced subsequently. Yep. So which kind of gave a huge hit as but what it also taught us that period was that this entire space of when a consumer when a consumer applies for a loan online, lot of process happens offline, and offline was completely on a halt. So that was the time which gave us to kind of go back and work with the partners and work on a seamless through and through digital system for consumers. So that we took that period to kind of build that entire digital or through and through digital prison. So that when things come back to normal, we are ready to kind of serve the customers and provide them loans quickly. So that was the initial shock period, and then it was more of learning and trying to use technology to kind of bridge the gap between be digitally ready when the consumers and things come back to normal. So right now, I think while things post the second wave, we are pretty much back to our original pace where we used to be. And now that we have both the technology ready and also the offline working well, so things are looking up right now.
Yeah, so we will come back to you for more online and offline, the mixed stories. Continuing the brand perspective, Mani, do you want to chime in for how was it for you?
Sure. So I'll just take 20 seconds to give a perspective of our company. So we operate three brands. One is housing.com. The second is makan.com. And both these are internet marketplaces where people can buy or rent or sell homes. And then the third brand which we operate is PropTiger, which is an offline brokerage. Now, from the point of view of the pandemic, I think one of the things that all of us in the brand space in real estate missed out was emphasizing the importance of the house. And that's something that consumers really brought out, during the various surveys, saying that a house is the safest place where we can be in. So the use case of owning a house, became very, very important. And that's something that consumers define for themselves. The second thing which we noticed is that the rapid pace of digitization in the ecosystem, developers have spent on digital marketing to various degrees, and a lot of brokers have started participating in the whole digital ecosystem. But we think that the pandemic brought about an acceleration in digitization by a few years, where we saw brokers, developers, consumers all move online very quickly, engage online. So earlier on, people just used the internet to discover homes online, but now people are largely using portals such as us and tools such as 3D walkthroughs and drone shoots to actually shortlist homes and only go to the site when they actually want to buy homes. So the whole sector has digitized. And along with that, one of the things which you have seen is the rapid growth of adjacent industries. So for example, during the pandemic, we launched the parent product and we launched like online tenant agreements and tenant verifications. So all those services have gathered steam and picked up pace. So overall, it looks to us like it's going to be a very exciting time from now on, so far as the real estate space is concerned.
With three very unique brand perspective, I am looking to Siddharth to add in from a media agency efforts standpoint of view, given that using media in a very agile fashion had been also a very critical part of the ecosystem during all this while.
Yeah, so definitely, and hello everyone. What we saw was that last decade was defined by brands adopting search and social as two main channels for digital. And of course, branding was is also being done on digital, but TV and print were the biggest mediums as well. And of course, all the mediums will continue, but as every panelist has been saying, digitization has increased quite a lot and we have seen a compression. And that's exactly what we saw as well. And just a bit about our company. So we focus a lot on programmatic display and video powered by data and data science capabilities. And what we are seeing is that display and video is being adopted by brands in a very, very big way. Pandemic actually really helped our business in a big way because data-powered display and video is something which brands are looking at to grow their upper funnel and mid funnel and then grow their brand. And as consumers, digital touch points have increased as well. All these channels have become very, very relevant and the acceleration has really happened. And another very interesting, information from me is that we launched our business in India entirely during COVID and we have grown entirely during COVID. So we actually don't know how, without COVID, how our business looks like. I'm looking forward to post-pandemic world when we'll actually know all the clients, all the agency partners we have acquired or we have got into partnership with are all through VCs like this. So we are a completely digital first, pandemic first business. Of course, we are a multinational company, yeah. But the India business has been built completely during pandemic time.
Well, thanks for bringing in the link, Siddharth, beautifully for my next question, because I was just shifting gears to entrepreneurship, which was another thing that went into hyperdrive during all this while, right? While we're talking about a lot of industries between non-essential and essential, which saw the hyperdrive way, we saw both at individual levers and also in terms of product diversification, a lot of things just, starting or disrupting right from scratch. So if given we have like this power pack, ideation group, what would be some of the things that you would recommend? One, there is added clutter. Second, we are saying that we are moving away from, say, aspirational or, the brand affinity. We used to talk about these terms in the, in the context of image association. And we're now shifting gears to sustainability. We're now shifting gears to more kindness, empathy, transparency. And Ashish spoke about, combating the trust issues that pandemic sort of brought with it for their industry. So what is it that, we can give to the entrepreneurs who are starting from the scratch in digital first space, largely with the focus? So in no particular order, I'm definitely looking to Sai, Mani, looking at your stories coming in, how the journey has been while building your brands.
Sai, would you like to go first?
So I think very, very interesting question and also a very good point that Ashish has touched upon the fact that, how important it was to build trust post-pandemic. And, a lot of times when we kind of start out, the entire communication and the entire marketing effort is to kind of, ensure that the product benefits come out and the communication is talking about those things. But the classical terminology of marketing is building trust, affinity, building preference for the brand. Those basics will never change. And even if some of the brands kind of take a different route, they usually come back. But coming back to the point of starting out digital first brand. So I've been with Pet Abadar for the past 7 years, and that's when that's when Sathavada was started in 2014. So I know for a fact that, initial challenges, how we used to have less of fun and we need to build a brand. But what our starting point was very, very simple, that we need to solve a simple consumer problem. There is a consumer who is looking for a lending product and there are banks which are lending to them. And in between, what is our role? Our role was very simple, that can we simplify this process for them, which is create a platform which simplifies, A, de-organizes financial products to a consumer, B, creates a platform which where a consumer can come simply compare each and every product and apply for a loan or a credit card or a home loan or any other product and create an endless, seamless process for the consumer. So that was the starting point, which is to, can we simplify this process for them? And while starting out, I clearly remember that, it was always, we always used to discuss which route to take. I always use the example that Surf Excel, for the longest time, their communication was, which was was the core product benefit. And it took a long time for them to come up with an interaction campaign called Dirt is Good, and therefore Dal Exchange, which is a higher order benefit. So we always used to have this debate about, you know, should we go hardcore, you know, sell a get instant loan, or build a larger theme of what we have right now, which is called Paisa Samarthak. So it is a journey. Like, you know, initially you are more you tend to lean more towards pushing the product benefits, which we did in the beginning, because that's what we wanted to do, which is we wanted to tell that, you know, Paisa Bazaar is here to simplify your lending needs. And if you apply on Paisa Bazaar, you can instantly get a loan. And that's where at the back end we were trying to, you know, put all the processes together. But as Ashok also shared, that, you know, how it's important to build trust also with the brand. So moving ahead in the journey of our of building a brand, we also came up with a different set of communication. I'm sure a lot of you have seen the entire Paisa Se Badhkar campaign, which is a promise beyond just a month. So it's a journey of the brand that you take. You know, it's more leaning towards instant gratification.
Correct.
And then the journey moves towards, you know, building trust and so on and so forth.
That's a very interesting perspective of playing communication first and listening in, you know, before the product, and then sort of getting an outside in perspective. Do you want to weigh in, Mani, on this?
Sure. So you know, I'll talk about whole evolution of brand and evolution of housing.com.
Yeah.
I think the first wave of branding was done by the founders and the initial promoters of the company. Before I joined, and that was a big bang campaign, which focused on a more bringing awareness to the market. There's a brand called housing.com, and it's a new company, but we are trying to do something different from what 99acres and Magic Bricks is doing. So that was the first phase. Then, as most of you know, and most people in the audience would know, you know, the company, you know, went through a lot of trauma. Where, you know, the founder and CEO was terminated by the investors, and at that time the company was struggling for financing and also for cash, but at that point in time, you know, we had to do some branding because you know, from the trade side of it, people were like, your competitors are branding, you have 99acres Magic Bricks branding, you're not out there. And, you know, we are hearing news in the media that housing is going to shut down. So we were forced to do some sort of branding. We really didn't have a great audience to talk about. We didn't have a great suite of products to talk about. So we focused more on the fact that home buying is more an emotional decision. And we tried to establish an emotional connect with the audience, more likely with people in the middle and with the older age group. So that was the second phase of branding. The third phase of branding was in 2019 and early part of 2020, where we had built a great product suite. We had a great audience to speak about, and we were fairly clear in terms of where we wanted to go with our product suite. And we also wanted to be clear about what the messaging was. And at that time, having built sizable audience, we found that women were very strong influencers in the home buying process. So the brand positioning we took was women are very strong buyers. And so the ad centered largely around women. So we had Kiera Advani and Vicky Kaushal, who are brand ambassadors. And along with that, we also focused on technology, saying that, look, we have something called Smart Search, where you don't need to spend too much time on the platform, and you have whatever you know need to get, and we will match you fast with the dream home of your choice. And the most recent phase of branding is when we built in. We are now the market leaders in supply. We are now the market leaders in demand. But now we said that you know, home buying may sound like a torturous journey to a lot of people, and a lot of people need to put in a lot of effort. And we showed the fact that people have to put in a lot of effort offline, but we said now the market has largely come online. So housing is the one place to go, whether you want to buy a house, to rent a house, whether you want to look for a mover, packer, whether you want to paint a house, whether you want to look for a home loan or you want to sign a tenant agreement or pay your rent. So it was kind of like a comprehensive one-stop shop for all needs associated with home.
That's a very holistic way of putting it, which is one, not taking the route of hiding. And in fact, we have seen in a couple of consumer studies at our end that engaging with the consumers in stress situations just like, you know, brings in the trust manifold. And that has really worked right from the onset of pandemic for the brands who have been right there visible in front of the consumers. It has sort of like added that gravitas in terms of trust. We move to touch points now, and it's said that, you know, brand story for a marketer is almost something which is unfolding through all your customer touch points. And the mix of omni-channel and the marriage between offline and online, we saw some very interesting stories and beautiful rigor from brands during pandemic. Of course, post-pandemic doesn't really exist. But while we are at it, we have seen some of the amazing work being done by brands across. And I know some stories really exist over here. So Ashish, do you want to talk about how it was for Swiggy and some of the initiatives from your delivery partner's perspective?
Sure. So Isha, actually, I think I'll just start off with when it came to omnichannel, I think what was the challenge, and maybe going back to trust, for instance. I think interestingly, what's when we can like think about what's happened because of consumers interacting with the world largely through digital, I think the number of brands, the number of advertising, the number of products you kind of like come across has obviously increased a lot, and hence the role that trust plays in terms of kind of like helping you kind of like choose has increased manifold as well.
Correct.
So as in all of us use ratings, number of reviews as like default ways. And in fact, you're probably more comfortable making a good choice on a e-commerce website with good ratings and review systems than in a supermarket where you're like, where are the ratings and reviews here, right?
Yeah.
So from that standpoint, I think we also realized that the role of social proof has increased a lot when it comes to digital. Consumer mental models have changed a lot in terms of how they kind of like pick brands. And that's something that we really kind of like felt was powerful, right? So when we try to apply that in our particular case, and going back to the trust deficit that consumers had, a key insight for us was that when you essentially see one, people around you ordering food, you're like, okay, they're doing it, so must be all right. When you see delivery partners starting to kind of come to your apartment building, you're like, okay, that means there must be people ordering. So I really need a break from the food I'm eating. So I think I should get back to ordering. So we use these insights to kind of like craft a campaign and make it omnichannel in that sense. So we had social proof that kind of like cut across nationally through a IPL level campaign. But when you came to your app, you would actually see for a particular restaurant, you'll have mentions of how many people have ordered recently to kind of like give you that level of social proof, right? You'd see delivery partners around you, obviously branded, wearing Swiggy gear, which was another dimension of social proof. So that's how we kind of like coupled our, as an inner way, omnichannel marketing strategy. We aren't present in stores, so not omnichannel in the traditional way. But for us, that was our cut on how we took things.
That's very insightful, Ashish. Siddharth, do you want to chime in and give us some examples of how you would have supported brands in the omnichannel space?
Yeah, so we have a very interesting case study with L'Oreal, which also recently won a very prestigious award for us. So this is for the L'Oreal professional brand, who have thousands of salons affiliated with them throughout India. And of course, meaning during lockdowns or even in general during pandemic, they wanted to support their salon partners, and they also wanted to, of course, support their consumers as well. So so it was a mix of various things, right? So we have our own data management platform where we were able to leverage some of the signals like consumers using beauty apps or consumers who are frequently visiting salons or interested in beauty care and hair care and so on. So mixing the signals which are there between offline and online, and then arriving at the right consumer and targeting hyperlocal way in the areas which are around the salons, right? And then the other innovations which we did was that we knew that consumers are not able to easily go out, but these are not the consumers who are kind of looking at purely, just from an online perspective, their entire journey. They need some advice. They need some help in terms of choosing the right products, etc. So what we did was we have a very interesting technology where we convert the best performing social posts and creatives into to be used in programmatic environment and extending the reach. And that can include videos, etc. So, you know, you can have some education or some interesting engagement around that. And then landing those consumers into the WhatsApp business account of L'Oreal, where a beauty expert or a hair care expert would advise the consumer that, okay, this is your query, this is how we can help you, and this is the address of the nearest salon, and, you know, salon can then deliver the product and maybe provide some services, etc. as well. So building that last mile connectivity was also a big theme in that. And a very, very interesting another feature which we used was that we also looked at what is the online behavior and demand pattern. So like consumers searching for beauty and L'Oreal products online, as well as browsing for those products. What are those timings? And on a real-time basis, increased or decreased the intensity of the campaign so that then, you know, when consumers are online and browsing and looking for such products, we are, you know, reaching out to more of them. And when, you know, basically capturing the timing and delivering the campaign at the right moments, that creates another whole level of efficiencies. And so, yeah, it was a very, very successful campaign where we were able to deliver three times better CTR than the average which they were having. They also drew a lot of business revenues out of that, which, you know, we cannot reveal in our case study. But yeah, very successful campaign, which is getting repeated on a periodic basis.
Congratulations to you on that. And that also, I think, has a great message on hyper localization and personalization in the customer experience cycle as well. Further, you know, continuing this topic, I know that we have more stories on Omnichannel. Sai, do you want to talk about more digital ways of working? I know that's something close to your business.
I think I briefly spoke about in the beginning, but you know, I think for us, lending, especially if you look at lending, you know, pre-COVID, there was an over-dependence of on physical and offline processes, like, you know, the KYC verification, documentation, document pickup, getting wet signatures, and all of these processes used to be pretty much you know, offline. While the consumer used to come on a platform and create. Just use the bank and so on and so forth, but a lot of process was still offline. But post March, when things were brought to standstill, in the last 8 odd months, there have been a remarkable progress towards digitizing lending. Today, if you look at even the largest banks are innovating and building processes and working with fintechs like us and technology providers to build an end-to-end process. So even even the large consumer segment today can avail a personal credit card with a complete paperless and paperless process. But having said that, truly digital would be like, for example, if a person is trying to apply for a loan even at a store or at a bank, if he is offline and from there he's trying to apply for a loan or credit card, can he get that within minutes? That will be the real challenge. So yeah, so from where we were, there's been a remarkable improvement in the entire process of getting a loan to the consumer without a paperless in the business process.
Yeah. Also, you know, then bringing in money to this, you know, this piece as well. I know there are two digital first brands that you are leading, and also this Prop Tiger. So some of the things that you saw for, you know, across brands from an offline perspective, or like some thought leadership pieces, I think we briefly spoke about that yesterday when we were catching up.
Sure. So we operate three brands, Housing, Makan, and Prop Tiger. And being a startup, you know, we just don't have the resources to build two brands. So early on in our journey, once, you know, Housing merged with the LRR group, we decided that Housing.com is going to be the consumer-facing brand. And Prop Tiger is a brokerage, and till now it's been a largely an offline-facing business. Though with the pandemic, things are changing around. So in the case of PropTiger, you know, we just don't have the wherewithal to go and do brand marketing. And also brand marketing is really not needed. Also, the other thing is that Housing operates at the top end of the funnel where people are searching and discovering, and PropTiger is the bottom end of the funnel where you're dealing with fulfillment. So communicating like two different brand messages is going to be was going to be very difficult. So what we decided was in PropTiger was that we wanted the people that we were dealing with to really believe and trust in us. And so the position that we take, and that's what we do in practice, is that we work as property advisors. And also the customer base that we work with on PropTiger are the top tier developers. And we never sell a product where we are not confident that the developer will not deliver the product, right? So that's one piece. The second on PropTiger is, you know, we've launched several online initiatives where we talk to consumers about, you know, how important it is to do a site visit and how do you stay safe during a site visit. We also have a prop guide, right, where we are very, very neutral. We never talk up or talk down a particular, or rather talk up a particular product or a particular developer because you're working with them. We want to provide like a very, very neutral perspective on the market. And also, you know, we have thought leadership. So for example, we publish a Real Insight report, which is acknowledged as the report of choice in understanding trends in various micro markets across the country. So the other thing which we do is that we focus a lot on NPS. For example, the NPS score on PropTiger is about 75 to 80. And we measure the satisfaction of customers through every touch points. Every time a relationship manager talks to a customer, we measure that interaction. And we don't leave out a single interaction. Because ultimately, you know, we want customers to kind of refer us.
Yeah.
And in fact, about 30 to 35% of our business today comes in from existing customers referring us to other customers. And that's a great way, you know, to build up an audience and build up a customer base without having to spend on it. So these are the tools which we use at PropTiger to kind of position us as a trusted partner.
I'm summing it up. I heard a lot of education and using, you know, like being a support to the community in terms of building that, you know, that brand positioning for yourself. And second, you NPS. So I'm just taking that on, and because that really gives me a spark of being a researcher. So bringing in data into our scheme of things from touch points, if we can also, you know, have more data driven personalization stories. We saw that hyper-localization has become like the buzzword at the moment, and across sectors again, we saw some very minute, like detailed strategies to address to certain cohorts, right from, you know, having the correct tonality for millennials, for Gen Z and or Gen Y at the moment, to even non-metro story, right, in terms of the tonalities and the voice that we are using. So coming back to you, Ashish, for this, because I know that personalization is something that was a very beautiful, brings in a lot of beautiful Swiggy winning stories, right? So something that you did, which was, hinged on data.
Got it. So yeah, I think we have a lot of fun with our data as well. We use it for making important decisions, but we also like to have fun with it. So a couple of interesting case studies there. I think when you think of clutter, I think your email inbox is probably the most cluttered place in the world for most people. And getting a brand's email to really kind of like jump out and getting consumers to engage with that is really hard, right? So I think two beautiful ideas, and all credit to our creative team, I think, that we executed. One was, a couple of years back, appraisals were right around the corner. It was like year in season, and we had a appraisal mailer go out to all consumers, which effectively had, in a way, your appraisal as a foodie. So you got like titles. I hope you all got that. So yeah, so that was again a very interesting way of kind of like using personalization to make the message a lot more personalized, relevant to you, and also kind of like definitely evocative. So that was one. Then this year, again, we found another opportunity when the board exam results kind of like came out. So we realized that these board exams were also very different from previous ones. So again, we kind of like use data to, as in give everyone their board exam results in a way when it comes to eating food, right? So those were two, as in pretty interesting stories. And we had a lot of consumers appreciating what we did. So those were two that stood out for me. And again, hat tip to our creative team who comes up with cool stuff like that.
Yeah, no, thanks for sharing. I think they were like great branding inspirations, fun plus food. Siddharth, do you want to chime in and add in more from data perspective in you know, the consulting that you're doing for brands?
Yeah, so I think this is something which is going to become very big as we see in this decade. Is first of all, the usage of the first party data, and I'm using a bit of a jargon, but in simple terms, it's all about, you know, there are so many digital brands, and also there are brands who might not have digital touch points, but they still have a lot of customer touch points. So leveraging all your consumer touch points and understanding, first of all, what data you have about your consumer, right? It could be cookie IDs, device IDs, it could be email IDs, phone numbers, whichever way, right? Yeah. And then from there, and of course, you can do primary research as well, right? But the point here is that leverage all your data sources, and then you can, you know, use data management platforms and other tools to further enrich that data in the right way, GDPR compliant way and legal way, right? But basically have a very, very good understanding of your consumer. And just to share, you know, on this, like a case study. So we have a very interesting case study with a financial services company, and they were looking at, you know, kind of providing the credit cards to their consumers. But of course their bar was very, very high. And, you know, in these scenarios, typically search works very well, of course, and I'm going a bit deeper into media part as well, but this will really explain what I'm trying to say. And then you also want to do other channels, but then those channels obviously don't give you the best of the quality. And that's where the power of first party data comes in. So this, what this brand did was, and we helped them, is we helped them understand who are their consumers who are filling in the leads for their credit cards and then who are actually getting approved. So what is the profile of their approvers? And we looked at 500 plus data signals, which can include demographics, it can include appography, browsing behavior, domains, contextual signals, offline brand affinities, and so on and so forth as well. So very, very rich understanding of the consumer who is getting approved for the credit card was developed. And then from there, you know, targeting was done. And that campaign outperformed all the other push channels in a very, very big way. So that's the power. If you, you know, and the reason why I'm really emphasizing this is because we are getting into this decade where brands will focus on a lot of push channels or channels which build up the upper funnel and mid funnel. And that is very important because as you want to grow your brand searches on search engine, as well as you want to grow your direct and organic traffic, that this is the medium which will really help you. But to do it efficiently, you have to really understand your consumer, and the best way to do it is use your first party data, enrich it, and then you know, take your first best step in your push channels, push market.
Oh, very, very well said, Siddharth. Also doing a quick time check as we're almost coming full circle to the close of the session almost. Sai, do you want to also add in on this from a data, you know, data perspective? Were there any, you know, breakthrough data points that led to campaigns or brand voice ideas?
So I think one specific example I can think of is that, you know, as you all know, perhaps lending is perhaps the only category where the seller chooses the buyer. Basis a lot of there's a lot of their credit profile and their the quality of the lead and everything. So so it becomes extremely important for us to create within our platform have a system wherein the buyer actually knows which bank he's going to choose. So we run this entire credit score program on our platform, which never used to exist earlier. So earlier what used to happen was when a consumer used to come to our platform, he used to choose a bank that this is where I want to take the loan from, and the bank he used to go to the bank, and the bank used to 6 out of 10 times reject that person, saying that, you know, you have a bad credit score. And at that point of time, I had to ask few of my friends also, they were not even aware of their credit score. So what we did was we kind of, you know, built the entire credit score back, on free credit score on our platform, wherein a customer, the moment he used to come, we used to tell him, hey, this is your credit score, and you have a high chance of and this information also used towards pass on to the bank, saying that, you know, this customer, this is his credit score, and he has a high chance of approval with your bank. So that kind of, you know, enhance the consumer experience and also the partner experience. So now, where the personalization comes into play is that, you know, when so then we also added this entire feature. So if you have to take a credit score on any other platform, like Stable or anywhere, you have to pay 500 rupees. But on our platform, it's free. So it became a great customer acquisition strategy also for us. So we used to run entire digital campaigns, TV campaigns on creating an awareness about of credit score. But also what we did was when the consumer used to come on our platform, because we had the data and the information about his or her civil score, we used to serve them intelligent communication that, you know, hey, you have a home loan running. It's going on at 10.8%. If you shift to another bank, which is at 8.5, you could save, say, around 10 grand per month on your on your EMI. And that became a great value proposition. And all of that is coming purely from data. And also how consumers can get a pre-approved card on our platform. All these products could be built and these kind of communication use were able to go. So the entire, we ran the largest credit awareness initiative. And now a lot of others are also started following suit on you know, creating awareness on credit score. So this is how we kind of, you know, build the entire engine towards moving towards the personalization.
Yeah. All these stories definitely like strengthen up that data is an absolute friend for the marketer, especially in a time when it's changing how we are building the brands or how we are consuming the brands. We have been an absolutely orderly group in the order and scheme of things. Rejigging the energy a bit, I'm bringing in a you know, like a summary question and sort of just like jump in at no necessary order. What would be the two favorite buzzwords for each of you that you think is going to command, you know, the next 4 to 5 years and for brands that matter or brands that will break the clutter? You can use a word, you can use a statement, but like two themes which are absolutely favorite for each of you. Who wants to go first?
Hey, I think product-led growth is my favorite buzzword right now. I think, so I'll leave it at that. But I think that's going to be very important.
You have to give us two, Ashish.
Oh, okay. Probably your marketing tech stack. I think you can't bring a knife to a gunfight. So I think that's the other.
Sai, do you want to get? Do you want to go next?
Yeah, I think the biggest buzzword would be making your decisions on data as we spoke right now. You know. There is a limited budget for everyone has, so maybe on that. The other one, I can't think of right now. Yeah.
Okay, great.
I stand with.
Yeah.
Yeah. One thing that we kind of, you know, follow is that, you know, if you try hard, you can measure everything. That's something we kind of remember.
Yeah. Mani, Siddharth.
Yeah, I'll talk about a couple of things. So one is obviously being real estate, being you know, historically it's been an offline play, right? So driving innovation and in terms of new products and services. And the second and the larger challenge, which is facing all of us in the industry, is improving user engagement. So in real estate, typically, you know, you're in the market for, like, let's say a 3 to 4 month period, and then you probably come back to the market when you want to rent a home or to buy a home, right? So it's not a product like Swiggy where you probably need to use it every day. So we always constantly searching for new hooks to drive user engagement. In countries such as the US, you know, where you have Zillow, you have Zestimate, which is the value of the home. So people for either for vanity's sake or to look at pictures of beautiful homes, you know, people constantly visit the site. So for us, it's going to be like driving user engagement through increasingly bringing services online that consumers can engage.
Very interesting. Mani, closing comments from you, Siddharth.
Yeah, so, you know, I really loved this sentence, if you try hard, you can measure everything. I really love that. So I would say data-driven marketing is, you know, the buzzword, obviously. But within that, there are so many dimensions which are opening up. And one of the big thing which we are focusing on and we are seeing a lot of success is how do you take macro trends and look at that correlation with your brand consumer interaction and then tap into it. So for example, we had done we have a case study with a crypto exchange where we looked at Twitter signals, and we all know that when Elon Musk talks about any cryptocurrency, the entire crypto market goes other way, or the whole world of cryptocurrency kinds of moves. So those kinds of signals are very, very interesting to look into and then look at your marketing and do along with that. And the second part I would say is from a media perspective, this decade will be TV plus digital optimization would be very, very interesting. TV itself is transforming into digital TV or connected TV. And I think that, you know, from a media perspective, it will be a very, very fundamental but big trend which will be coming in.
Thank you, Siddharth, and thank you everybody for a very insightful session. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm sure the audience also did. We talked a bunch of things, but if I have to summarize, the three things that stood out were that the first was that one thing that will stay for brands that matter is staying relevant, real time, and also keeping the consumers engaged with the right tonality. Second thing was that measurement and data are going to be the friend for the marketer. Cross media, it's across channels with content getting the boom, that is going nowhere. And third, the product first piece that, you know, a lot of us spoke about, customer experience is going to be fundamentally, you know, like the most important thing. Even if, you know, like we can choose the right brand tonality and measure it, the customer experience is going to be the single most important denominator. But thank you everyone. I'll hand it over.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you so much, Isha. It was an absolute pleasure to listen to the whole panel. I'm really thankful to Isha, of course, for being the session chair, Ashish, Mani, Sai, Siddharth, for being so kind and joining us. It was a pleasure to have you all here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.